Good afternoon. We're going to start with the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, welcome to the our summer board workshop, and we'll go ahead and start with, well, let's see who's here. I'll do a roll call.
Dr. Spencer.
Here.
Hopefully. Mrs. Serville.
Here.
Mr. Sellers.
Here.
Mrs. Ross is here. Mr. Lipsky is not here. Mrs. Hilton.
Yep.
And Mrs. Dubé.
Here.
Six.
Hearing of school district patrons. Sharon, have you received
I've got nothing. Thank you.
Okay, we're going to start off with superintendent's goals, mid-year update, and Eric, you're going to take the lead on that, I'm sure.
Thank you. Can you hear me sitting here? Okay, so I didn't hear any other feedback, so I thought I'd follow the same format as in years past. It's a couple weeks later than usual, but this is a similar timeline to do this at a summer board workshop. We have notes and we'll be talking about things that were discussed to have an update at the summer board workshop. There are things that I will move past because they were either not slated to be discussed at this workshop or part of the end of year evaluation. But obviously, if you have questions on those, then those are my best to answer them. So, as is done in the past, the red items. And I've just given everyone a paper copy of this for ease rather than trying to find attachments electronically. The red updates represent brief summaries of response to the update. They will remain for the end of year update, and then we'll add another color blue, and usually as the end of year update, this document will just be added on to it. So it's exactly the same as we've done in the past. There's not an update on it. It does not mean that there is not So, I'm going to go through the red items. If there's supplementary information, it's noted in the attachment that consists of your packet. I'll probably stop if you have questions on those things or have suggestions for moving forward on those things. And it's just going to be kind of dialogue, if that's okay, going through the whole thing. Okay?
We're not attached up there.
We are not attached up there. You're attached right here. Correct. So first is the goal one, the item pertaining to legislative discussions. This year, most I think you all know that this is a year earlier than was expected. I am president of the K-12 Alliance of Michigan, the former Tri-County Alliance of Michigan. There are five counties involved in this organization now. And all kinds of superintendents association. We've been very active. I have, as usual, and this has not changed, with legislative discussions. Obviously, those are not super recent, not much in this area since June, but very active before June. Tomorrow is actually the first day of legislative session since the summertime. So they're only planning a very short number of session days from now until the end of the year, we hope. We're promoting in this area, no lame duck. There's not talk of a lame duck session, but there's no legislation I feel personally, I'm the board does the same, it's so critical that it should go through lame duck. Some of the see, I have an attachment there. We really needed to continue to focus on staffing in this area, and I owed you a plan for this, as was in the goals, to create a plan that the additional staff that you approved budgetarily will be doing. I think there are many comments by board members made that they didn't want this just to be not just a reduced caseload situation where our additional mental health support people were not just taking on fewer numbers of students each, but would be a program, would be working for a program more formally. Our first draft of that program exists in attachment A. Obviously, there's a tier approach. We have a number of support personnel in the district now, and they have various roles based on the building that they're in. And it's a three-tiered approach where tier one is all students exist in tier one. They move into tier two when need additional intervention, and tier three when need the most intervention you offer in school. But then we also have a referral process out of the way from tier three if they need additional and more intervention than that. We formalized all this more. We've been working with buildings to formalize this process for our students. And this is being done with our social workers, counselors, aides, deans, all the way through classroom teachers. So you can see the role that people play on this. We're doing more in the area of group work, group meetings, restorative practices, in order to try to keep people from progressing through the tiers to go back to tier one, which is where we want people, as many students to be as possible. In instruction, there's quite a bit here on that, but in some work in instruction, I know the board, when I say the board, these came from individual comments of board members, but I resonate them in this update. The board, we talked about data quite a bit in the January or February goals meeting, and there was a fair amount of consensus on creating baseline right now. This time frame that we're in right now would be the creation of or the establishment of baseline data to move forward from. There are several things in this area that are attached. First of all, we have a plan for what the literacy support specialists are doing and have been doing with our students and our teachers at our elementary buildings. That is attachment B. Not only what they've done so far, but the plan for this year. It's divided by middle school and elementary school. We recommend 5, the board suggested adding 6 or 8, and we have 3. If you look at attachment C, you can see, again, following the same tier model that we look at with social-emotional support, the way that they work with students, these particular group of people work with students. Tier 1, that they have an impact on all students at the school. Tier 2, working with, we've identified students with NAD scores 21st to 40th percentile and below their grade level reading score. And then tier 3, the greatest amount of intervention that are below the 21st percentile and above below grade level, the strategies they're working on with those students individually. So it's whole group, whole class, small group, and then all the way down to individual work. And that is working, that program exists with our literacy specialists at all of our elementary and middle schools going on right now. You can see with that, you can see it's divided between middle school and elementary. You also see in attachment D a sample of how the students are screening to make these determinations. So you can see it's not just one set of data that's used for determining what intervention the students need. There's a number of reading and comprehension assessments the students go through, and they can move in and out of these things. So as you know, NWA tests repeatedly throughout the year, 3 times a year, and they are tested throughout the year, and as they improve, they move off with greater intervention, and if they need more intervention, they move up the situation as well, or move up the tier levels as well. You can see it, there's growth with these students. Obviously, they're getting more one-on-one work and attention. We hope to have something comprehensive for you in December as to how exactly the students that have changed. You can larger attachment E speaks to NODA. This is our, this is what we call our baseline data. This is a core answer to this goal. You can see, as we've shown before, why 80% of the kids can be in tier one, 15% is tier two, and 5% or less in tier three is the goal. You can see where we're at right now on the next page. Better shape in some grades than others by meeting that. And you can go through the document and look specifically at grade levels and the percentage of those students that are at grade level meeting and what category we have placed them in according to the model. No attachment for this, but the last bullet on this one is that we have really looked at corrective reading classes in the secondary building, especially grade 9. Corrective reading is a program that we've trained our reading specialists on, and we are working on the secondary on this as well. So if the students need this intervention further past 8th grade, when they are not literacy specialists in buildings 9 through 12, they as a corrective reading course. Nancy has been trying this as well, started with a special education mission well before specialist, and this is expanded out to grades in time school.
Okay. Aaron,
please go ahead. Yes.
Oh, go ahead.
Let's go.
So my question is in regards to looking at, I am looking at attachment E.
B.
E as an elephant?
E as an elephant. Go ahead.
When do we, the 17, well, those are social workers, reading assistant people that we hired in. I can't think of the name of them, the correct
term. Reading specialist.
The reading specialist, is that
what
they're
reading specialist? Literacy
specialist.
Thank you. When did they start working?
This is their second, this is the beginning of their second year.
Can we explain then, in looking at E, when you look at the initial, elementary initial data for 2021, and then you look at the elementary spring 2022, the GRL reading data, how did we go from zero well below in kindergarten to 7% below if we implemented these reading specialists or literacy specialists?
So the expectations at kindergarten at the end of the year are obviously much higher than they are at the beginning of the year. So I am not concerned to see that anything at GRL level. Is that what you're looking at?
Yeah,
looking
at GRL.
Yeah. Initial last fall at the end of the year.
Yeah.
Laura. So you're saying it's the timing of the testing?
Yes, yeah, so at the end of the year, and the expectations for kindergarten have risen over the past couple years. So I'm not surprised to see that the measure at the beginning of the year is very small, and then they're expected to do a lot more by the end of the year.
Another comment is well below gain from not being 7%.
Right.
The below students dramatically decline and the above grade level students increase.
Is there any way that we can then, would it be a different kindergarten? I want to compare apples to apples.
I know what you're saying.
All the same kids have grown over time.
So when we created, we gave a lot more data in a lot of different ways so that as a baseline we can look at next year, we go spring to spring and spring to spring, so we can watch these kids over time, which to me is a lot more time than just the fall to spring.
Right.
So we'll be able to look at next year and see where what those kids at the end of first.
So to do that, Larry, you want to look at the kindergarten spring 2022
to first
717-76 to the first grade fall scores that are happening now. Sorry,
Yeah.
For those same kids, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So actually, your fall to spring and then a spring to fall would be a very good assessment, especially if you're keeping the same cohorts, because then you know what are they using over the summer, and do your interventions actually make a difference?
Yeah.
So if you're not doing that fall to spring, you don't have any idea whether or not you're impacting.
Exactly.
So
we collect it.
Like a year at a time isn't going to be enough.
Do the parents know that the child is behind in reading and they need to encourage the child to read more?
Yeah, so right now they're taking their fall NWEA test as well as their GRL, so at elementary The third grade reading law requires that we assess them all within the first 30 days, so we're doing that now. Everyone gets there also, per legislation, everyone, K-12, will get their report within 30 days of administering the test. So we'll get the NWA report that shows where they are percentile-wise. And across K-12, we're using the same percentiles for that red, yellow, and green, so that'll become familiar to everyone now.
Yeah.
We pushed NWA all the way up through 12 this year. And then at elementary, they're also given the guided reading assessment. If they fall within that well below category, they do receive an individualized reading plan per the third grade reading law, and that's presented at conferences, which we don't wait until the report card at elementary. We do it at mid-marking so that we meet those legislative deadlines and that parents are a part of creating that plan for reading.
If a child is not in, is in the below 25 percentile, is we right away start working with that child, right?
Yes.
So does that teacher that's working with that child tell the, get a hold of the parents and say, your child is behind, so please have them read and practice and
yep.
things
and
like that?
And they go with your two small group yep. reading instruction.
If they're that low, the literacy specialists were all trained last year and we can hit the ground running this year right away in the fall. If they're below the 21st percentile, they're screened for corrective reading, which is more of a decoding issue. So they're screened for corrective reading. If they fall within that category, the intervention they receive is in that area. If they don't qualify to do corrective reading, then they're in a different group that focuses on the comprehension if that's their issue. So last year we really moved with training them, and they were by mid-year pretty good at screening the kids. And K-8, they screened all the kids under the 21st percentile, so that was quite a task for the first year. And this year we'll be able to do that right away when their testing is done in the next 2 weeks.
Okay. Eric, in regards to your goals and attachment E, moving forward with your goals, can we keep kind of like what exactly what Mary said, can you present to us?
Yeah, I mean, we want to lead so you can see the discrete grades though as well, correct?
Correct, yes.
So the suggestion is to essentially add cohorts that grow with time.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Compares.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Yes.
I mean, I understand what you're asking.
Thank you.
So I hear a lot about what we're doing with the kids. At what point are we actually doing an intervention with the parents, pulling the parents in? Because we all know that the kids will do what the kids are going to do, and we can keep adding to it, but really it's their home support that's our bigger issue. So do we have that facet covered, or is that something that we need to develop a plan for?
So the individualized reading plan requires an at-home component. So different schools do it different ways. They'll have entitled schools even more different than non-title schools. They'll have a parent meeting night. But they're all required at that meeting where they signed an individual reading plan. They are required to go over some at-home skills that align with the child's weaknesses, and it's written into the plan. So we do give them some tools and some.
So we have a parent reading night?
They do, yes.
Okay, what about beyond that? Because one meeting is not a parental intervention.
Yeah.
That's a parental awareness.
It's a partial answer. I mean, in reality.
No, it's a beginning.
Right.
It's definitely a start, but it doesn't mean a need.
The NWA report that goes all does give specific strategies.
It doesn't count because if these parents have kids that are that low functioning and not getting it, they're not reading that report and they don't care about it. I don't want to say they don't care about it. It doesn't have the impact that it needs to have. But as a district, we can certainly provide a parental intervention or at least begin a parental intervention because that is where, that would be the money shot, right?
So in this area, So falls under this bullet in the engineering strategy for this one, for parent support for students that engage their tier three reading instruction. Okay, so a goal around that area or work around that area.
Well, I think more than parental support, we need parental intervention, a way to reach them on another level. Because like I said, we can work with kids. We can work with kids, but unless it's important to them and important to their family, it doesn't have the same impact.
So, I mean, even are you thinking, Mary, even things like providing them with tools, providing them with ways to assist their student at home?
Just checking in with them.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Like, if you're just checking in with parents. But, and don't get me wrong, I do think that, you know, an initial meeting is a good thing, a parent support night or a reading night, whatever the actual term was. But if we're not always checking in, then it kind of goes by the wayside.
Yeah,
I mean, I think there's an awful lot of working moms here. How many of us as working moms were like all over this because,
I mean,
we're tired.
Some parents just like get the kid in front of the TV and they're not my problem anymore. And we've got to do something to encourage that the child reads. You know, no television for an hour and read instead.
Well, I'm not suggesting that we monitor their home life or that we...
No, we can't
tell them what to do. I just think that if we're checking in with them, we're encouraging the, you know, the support.
I think all we can really do is what we've done over the ages. You know, the same issue in our day was, you know, TV, and before that it was something else, and now it's games. But we can give resources, like as you suggest, and we can certainly have meetings that we can emphasize and give resources to parents. But and I think the other is to really be very pointed about what their performance level is and how much they've grown or not grown, so that sometimes parents are really data driven, and they, when they see that in black and white, sometimes it's a catalyst for some change. But other than that,
there's room for positive reinforcement.
Yeah.
If once a month you checked in with the parents and let them know what their growth, the child's growth was, you know, in a month, you should see some growth.
I agree with everything we're saying, but I would remind everyone too that I think in this day and age we have far more connection between teachers and parents in terms of weekly updates and things like that. And parents, I'm sorry, it's like leading a horse to water. We can provide them all the tools and resources. I mean, yeah. I knew when my kid was late for school that very day because of how much stuff we have available to look at. And, you know, Mary's point's very valid. You know, you got a boatload of working moms, it's hard to do all these things, but I think
working
we have...
Working moms and working dads.
Well, of course, that's a given.
Fathers are just as responsible for this.
I was just responding to what you had said about working mothers.
Sorry.
But the point is that we have a great deal of resources already, I believe, and I'm not saying we can't do anything different, but I don't want to negate the fact that I think we've done a whole lot in having our teachers stay connected with the parents, and then it becomes the parents need to stay connected with the students. And if there's a disconnect there, there might be a place that could be some encouragement, but...
And I am so concerned about the kids and their reading that I would even say, if you've got kids that... You have three kids and they're not progressing, and you see that there's not, if you talk to them, there's nothing going on at home. Can't we like keep them after school 2 days a week and work with them so that they really are getting somebody's working with them? Because
like Mary said, you can't really control what goes on at home, but there's a lot of school systems that rearrange the teaching and learning that goes on during the day, because we do have control over what goes on. That's why we have reading specialists. That's why most teachers don't even wait for once a week. They are making constant contact every day on these online systems, and a lot of parents tune into that more. So as much as I totally 100% agree with you, as a board of education and as an administrative, I think we have to focus on structuring our teaching and learning environment to provide those opportunities for kids during the day, versus we can't really say what parents should do in the evening, unfortunately.
Well, I was just working in this area to propose something.
Yeah.
Eric, I have a question.
Yes.
I know that sometimes teachers can get, you know, parents that come in and volunteer in a classroom, but I've read and I really agree with it, like retirees, grandparents, whatever, coming in and like coming alongside students that have a hard time with reading, and maybe it's just an extra, just an extra support for them. Do we do much of anything like that in the district? Because aside from vetting them as volunteers, what's the cost? And how cool is it for like a grandparent or a retiree to come in and start helping with students? Because that generational connection is fabulous.
Yeah, I mean, to have a grandmother come in and sit with some little kid. He may not even have a grandmother.
Exactly.
But this person is coming in and spending a half hour with him working on his reading and saying the words. You know, it's not reading quietly, it's saying the words out loud.
What's that, phonics?
Well, and see too, and this district has done a great job with that in the past as far as, I know it's, you know, you know, reading aloud to students no matter what their age, even though they're a high schooler, because we all know that kids can understand a lot more than they can read at any given time. So when somebody reads to them often, it spurs them on to say, oh my gosh, there's books like that. You know, it gives them a reason for wanting to read. And so Jim Trelease's books, of which South River Elementary and middle school and the high school, there was all kinds of work. Parents even got a copy of Jim Trelease's book. They gave all kinds of books that are great for reading aloud. So that's a great idea to have parents or interested
people. You know, if they come and the child reads to them, it's practice for the child. And, you know, it's like, well, she's like a grandma to me, and she spends a half hour with me. Mm-hmm.
Okay. I don't want to get too off the track because we have a lot to cover. Did you have any other?
We wrote that down as well.
Okay.
I have one last thing on goal number one, if I could. Eric,
yes.
Under your long-term goal, it says to improve the district's placement throughout the county and the state.
Yes.
Where do we currently sit as far as county and state ranking?
They're not ranking that right now. I mean, there's no poll that's probably using it.
How can we measure improvement if we don't have anything to
the only growth is
right here.
Yeah.
We have baseline of that Hillary's attachment
H.
Thank
you. Okay, thank you.
I wanted an MBA, but I don't have an MBA. That's the problem.
Okay.
I have an M step, but
I just want to know how we are in comparison to other districts in the area.
We have an M step. You can see it. It's a autopsy test. You know that. They used to release. That's a technical term. Right? Anyway. and MBA is something that is more. It's more informative because it shows growth, so it shows the difference in how teachers are impacting students. And it neutralizes initial ability levels of students in classrooms. So in an area where the level is very low to begin with, but the teacher shows a lot of growth, even if the students are all still not passing the MSNET test, that student is then more to affect those kids than a classroom of very high-performing kids who actually don't improve much over the years but still pass the MSNET test. You see what I'm trying to say? They used to be able to compare an MBA after COVID and after started doing that. So I have age, I have M step comparison. I was asked to create baseline data, that's what that is.
Okay.
But it's more narrow than I wish it to be.
So we probably need to reevaluate your long term goal on this.
I would think, because it's not as holistic as it once was.
Correct.
3 years ago.
Okay.
Measuring growth, Eric, is very helpful for us and our staff to kind of really do a deep dive and make changes to the curriculum or the assessment program. But to compare districts or whatever at that level, that's not
right. The problem with some of the tests is that high SES schools have a trend line of high scores on some of the tests. Lower SES schools don't, but that doesn't talk about the teaching and learning abilities, and it shows that.
Right.
That's what I was trying to say.
Oh, okay, I see. Okay.
My point is, there are schools that exist somewhere somewhere that have really high SES and are going to have really high NEET results, NEPSET results, NEPSET results.
Right.
There are schools that have very poor NEPSET results, but tremendous gains from where they get kids in very transient areas, and that's really where better teaching and learning is happening, and that's the part we should be.
Exactly.
Making the first, that's the part that's harder.
Exactly. And more, and really can be the catalyst for really important changes. So.
The goal two. Go ahead.
Oh wait, did you have?
No. Goal two.
Goal two.
Okay. There's a chart. I've got a lot of number of individual questions on this, so I thought we could provide this chart of status report of where we're at in contracts, so one can see. Here's how to do a little explainer of the columns. You obviously see all large organized groups on the chart. You see when the contract, the active contract was approved, is in the Board of Education approval in the wage reopener. That is if they have received a wage reopener in their current contract. It does not speak to the past. So they may have received one in the past, but that means if they receive one by you in the current contract parameters and when the current full contract expires. Any questions other than that?
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
There's a small update. I mean, this is just come straight from the budget. This is not a meeting we focus on as much as we do in spring, but regardless, the fund balance situation is printed there. It's just straight off of what was approved in the budget for last June. H is where G and H are
Hold on, if you don't mind, on goal two.
I'm sorry.
As far as the long-term goal to achieve and maintain 2% better than...
Yes.
Okay. I'm just wondering if, as we look forward at your goals, just to plant the seed, that obviously we talk about being fiscally responsible, you have to balance spending with saving. And obviously if we spend, that's going to impact the general fund.
Correct.
So while this long-term goal to maintain and achieve 2% better than the state required fund balance is still applicable, I think that when it comes time to add and change your goals or update your goals, what have you, somehow we need to put in that mechanism in regards to spending versus savings.
Sure.
Mm-hmm. So that's all I have on that.
Sorry, but I was answering the question.
Yeah, no problem.
G and H in concert together. So G is data from last year, NWDA. H is MSTEP summative data from spring of last year. We have I can provide county and state on the age data. It's not on here, I can provide it because I'm just giving it as a baseline. And you can see district summaries at the bottom. For my end of the year, I'll show where we're at in county and state on that. Because I think what the board is kind of was to establish growth goals from this baseline data. That's what I thought. Mm-hmm. I thought this was supposed to be the baseline data and establish growth or change from this data. Whatever it was, great, not good, wonderful, you know what I mean? So sort of like this, just give us the information and then let's talk about how it should change. I thought that was where we're going next.
We can, this is our students, but how do they rank statewide?
Right, I can give you that only for H and I can provide that. I don't have it on here, but I can provide that. I cannot do for G, which that's what I was trying to say 5 minutes ago. Mm-hmm.
G, what is RIT?
It's the scale score that they receive.
That's the actual number they get.
Yeah.
Oh, gotcha. Okay. What was that?
The RIT score.
The RIT score.
Okay.
It's a
percentage AO
score.
Wait, what is that? Okay, yeah. A lot of acronyms.
There is a lot.
You see, we have this NWA. This year, what do we add this year? For the department, which NWAs did we add for this year?
11 and 12.
Add 11 and 12.
And science at
and science in high school. So we continue to get closer to a K-12 blanket on this. So we will have, you can cohort this data. You can cohort this because you can keep the student's data is home to them, so they're changed over time. Connected to a teacher and then moving on to other teachers is not our track. We only data within our own district. MSTEP, obviously not. That's, we had some very, you know, I appreciate this being a baseline year for MSTEP because even though in 2021 we had a fairly high number of students take MSTEP, it had not been required for over 2 years. Yeah. So in some places they encourage kids not to take the MSTEP in years, in recent years. In some places, kids that were in person took the MSTEP and virtual kids did not. We encourage all kids to come in, even last year, to do this, but it was not a high percentage. It wasn't near the percentage of normal kids to take. Because actually, you know, there is a lot of data on this.
The last couple of years kind of don't count.
Right. So this data is real. This is all of our kids. Okay, this is all of our kids of in-person school from last year. So we did get all, I mean, we did the virtual kids on this too. It was quite a challenge to get the virtual kids tested under the testing rules for this. So they are in there. You're right. If you're wondering, virtual students from last year are embedded within this data. Okay. This is kind of neat. There's been a lot of work. The curriculum department's been very, very kind of mission driven on incorporating building-based data into school improvement plans. They really came along with the short-term goal of utilizing local assessments to create measurable objectives in school improvement plans. And this is not done top-down, it's done, there's a consistent model that everyone is sharing right now for how to do this. And there's a lot of accountability by buildings and their leadership teams and their instructional team, so every building has a school improvement team that includes their administrators and teachers in the building, and they are responsible for looking at their data at G and H in order to create growth plans that are beneficial to their school, obviously working with curriculum on this. And I is an example of a needs assessment for building. So I is basically a data set of building of what they look at. It's an unidentified building in the district, but it's a sample of what all buildings create and build. And then you see their multi-year reading, end of year reading scores as a sample. So you can see that trend line data changing in end of year by the building. So this is a single building in elementary school. What they would be looking at, they test three times a year, looking at that group of kids and how they're changing over a period of time. So this is called a needs assessment. It's done through NWEA. They just look at it frequently by our school improvement teams, and then they write goals for their building based on this data for end of year or the coming year. So this data they use to write goals for this year, correct?
Yes.
Yes.
And that's just, obviously they do it for math and other areas.
This is a sample, they do it for math, at least math and reading, and sometimes other areas as well. We really worked on, this one was delayed, J was delayed, but you can see this creates a continuous, this is what I'm planning on. Okay, so take a look at, this is data, this is what a one-page verbal plan starts to look like. They use the same modeling they've been using in tier one, the tier two, the tier three, the green, the yellow, and the red, and how to address kids in those three bands based on the data that they have. And this is what there are phases you can be in. You self-identify, you support, beginning, implementing. What's the last one, Lauren, Kim? What's a more complete one called? Is there one for like almost done, finished, or that just
Monitoring,
sorry, lost the last word. So we don't have any in that situation, but the final phase is to be monitored. So if they begin one, it implements, is successful, then it goes to monitoring, which basically means it continues but it doesn't receive a lot of attention, and then they add the beginning and implementing strategies. So you can see see this is real, this is from a building, this is, they look at their data on the top and the gray bars, and you can see what they're doing with their tier one students on the left side, those two columns, what they're doing with their tier two students, and what they're doing with their tier three students. They monitor this, and they adjust it year to year based on their data. So it's a direct tie-in from assessments to results within buildings and classrooms to what work needs to be done within those. We've really standardized this. This was done very independently, kind of more intensively in some places than others, quite honestly. We really tried to focus in on this and make this a big priority for all schools through this lens. What will be coming to you, you should look further down the page at the end of the year, is how the plan that was discussed earlier through MTSS will more formally identify at-risk learners and what support they specifically need. So tied in with this, the at-risk learning plan that was discussed and goals will be presented to you at the summit of meeting. I had a question on this, and it wasn't specifically stated for mid-year updates, so we're going to address that at the end of the year evaluation. And then normal pieces that were on there as well, as far as the program evaluation subjects for this year, areas of strengths and weaknesses for the program evaluation tool as well from last year. I have some TA information here. K, I'm going to pull that. K is a document that looks at our traditional versus traditional or transitional kindergarten information. Obviously, there have been questions about that. I think it's been a super successful program. Mm-hmm. And I think it's been very, very successful. We've basically transitioned our young students, our young kindergartners, many of them into this. We were close to being able to add a section of it this year. Not quite, but we continue to look at, you know, the six kids more than enough to add another section of what the distribution of young kids is. So we weren't quite at that mark, but we just add as many as we can have availability for. We do help parents, coach parents with this program. They ask, should my kid go into TK or should they be in regular kindergarten? Talk about that. We don't just look at their age. We have a cache data here that shows where they were in the fall and in the spring, and there's been very good growth in this program. So you can see. So if you look at the transitional kindergarten students, the right side of the attachment data, you can see to begin with 67% were at or above grade level expectation. When they entered kindergarten in the spring, 33% were below, and that grew to all kids being at or above. This should say spring 2000. Got a problem with this, I'm sorry. Maybe it's spring. Oh, I'm sorry. Let's go left to right. 66% were below, 34% were above when we started. 67% ended the year above, 33% below. So you flip the bottom.
But that was traditional.
That was traditional. In transitional kindergarten, the bottom two boxes, all the kids started below grade level expectations. That's why they were in transitional kindergarten. They were young, and they were, many of these kids were not preschool students, didn't have preschool, and you can see that all of them received or were above grade level expectations when they finished kindergarten. So the extra year makes a big difference. The extra year of transitional kindergarten makes a tremendous difference. It's too bad more kids weren't eligible for it, to be honest with you. I mean, this is for all birthday kids who meet the minimum age for kindergarten, but aren't ready for full kindergarten yet. So it's like full kindergarten students. So
in order for us to get reimbursed for it, they have to meet the age requirement.
That is correct.
That's
right. They can't be a preschool age.
Can we body that? Because if we can start them at four in the transitional.
That's a very good thing to do.
We do start some of them.
I'm sorry, that was the wrong word. We're not allowed to laugh.
Right.
Advocate for.
Advocate, right.
Yes.
Well, you're right.
But we do start before.
But it took all of our
dates. You can start before if there are birthdays before a certain date, right? But what I'm saying is if we had the ability to open this up to even younger kids still, I think it would be a very highly utilized program. It would be great for kids.
You mean like universal preschool?
Oh, imagine.
Right.
Like open it up to four-year-olds. Because many four-year-olds are ready for kindergarten.
But it shows if done at a slower pace, they're ready for kindergarten material. It's not the pace of traditional kindergarten. The difference between this and preschool is that it is kindergarten, but it's just done
slower.
Yeah, it's done in a non-pressurable pace. The pacing guide, the timeline of finishing units, when it has to be done, is not there. You know what I mean? The pressure is not there on those individuals, and it's successful because they can move at the speed of the student, not at the speed of the average.
Yeah, I would be interested to know what if the district chose to shoulder the bill in implementing this program.
Can you? If
the district chose to fund the program, as opposed to
that would be incredibly excessive.
I would wonder what that number would be.
You mean for all kids?
Yeah.
Like, what do you mean for all kids?
4 year olds.
4 year olds.
So right now we currently have transitional kindergarten in two buildings, correct?
Yes.
That's correct.
What if we had an all building?
Well, we do get a full FTE for them because they are considered kindergarten students, mm-hmm. and in the big picture of the world, they're considered retained, but mm-hmm. they're doing kindergarten twice. Mm-hmm. We have explored when we started, we went on the tour of the classrooms, we are kind of tight on space to mm-hmm. be able to offer it at every building. Mm-hmm.
But if, I'm just wondering in like, magical land.
Oh, and magical land.
If we had the room in every building,
I know.
If we wanted to run this program in every building, if we wanted to provide it,
mm-hmm. what would that cost the
price tag be?
The first and second week of school, are there openings?
Right.
And there are not.
Right.
And our waiting list is not for long.
But it's there.
Right now, but yeah.
Yeah.
It's interesting to me that, I mean, my 27-year-old, when he was in preschool, it was pre-K, it was K-4, K-5, all that long ago. And we're still sitting here in public education saying, we should think about doing, you know, four-year-olds. I don't know why it's still an issue.
Well, my kids came out of daycare. They could read already, and they're just turning five coming here. And they're reading, and they know their letters, they know their numbers, they know their colors, they know all the things that they're going to learn in kindergarten.
Ours came out already able to write, and if I'm still correct, we are only introducing writing in third grade. Is that still a thing? Writing. When do we introduce writing in this district?
Kindergarten.
Okay. Because it used to be a lot longer, and there's no reason for that to happen. But again, this is a long time for why we haven't. Parents are looking for it. They're looking for daycare. And I'm not saying this is daycare, but I'm saying it's something that could answer some questions for them. It could certainly help our students. You're young, so you don't meet the age criteria according to the state thing, but that doesn't mean that you don't have the potential to do this work. And there's this thing right here. I mean, you come in fall 2021, 100% below level.
Yep.
Spring 2022, 100% above level. They can do this work. They can do this work. So maybe this is something we, you know, start fighting for in Lansing, but there's no reason not to have this going on.
I don't know this for a fact, but it further suggests that some of the kids in the traditional kindergarten program could have benefited from being in the
program. Right.
There's just so much you could teach that kid. By the time they get out of regular kindergarten, they could be reading at first grade level and doing all those things that a first grader is doing.
Mm-hmm.
So you're excelling them. And the ones that are not quite there, you can get caught up in first grade.
Exactly.
It's complicated because even the state savvies of the fact that, because Laura mentioned it, but about the FTE, and then, you know, then the state came out and said, we're only paying for one kindergarten experience and then you have the retention. I'm not saying that it wouldn't be great, but you just really have to structure it in a way that it's not going to hurt the district. And let's face it, kids learn at different speeds, and we do structure things so that some kids can pick it up fast and some kids take longer, but that doesn't mean anything.
Right. So let's talk about goals.
Yeah.
Let's go back to that.
Okay.
Sorry, legitimate questions should be questioned and answered. So.
Totally. I agree.
Absolutely.
We're ready to move on.
Okay. Thank you. Any questions on goal 3? Any others?
Nope.
There's a lot of other things out here that are important. This is really good. 4. I've updated the law as it's been ongoing for the past few years. And there will be more updates in the documentation on bullets 2, 3, and 4 as well. I have some ideas on the last one that I'm working on right now that will be presented to you at the summit meeting.
What's up, Rumbles? I didn't hear that.
Well, I'll have something for you on 2, 3, and 4 bullets on goal 4.
Gotcha.
And I have something I'm working on the final one for establishing consistent communication with the superintendent's office. 5. I'm kind of excited about a couple things in goal 5 right now that this team guide is working on more directly. It's been a while, and sometimes these can be cliche, but sometimes they can be very powerful too. We're working on a book I can share with the board as well, called Build to Last. It's an educational management book, but it's not something you buy into. It's not a proprietary software or something like that. It is engaging in driven, mission-oriented work even when things are challenging. It recognizes a variety of different staff and students in the building. It recognizes how to work through challenging problems. I think it helps build resiliency. It's helped me build resiliency. It helps build ways to reach out to people who are challenging and struggling and not feeling as well, and how to try to help them connect with the organization. I can't say that I planned this, but we got lucky that the author of this book is going to be in the area this year, and several of our principals are going to be going through this, and I'm going to be doing this with them. The professional development working through this. It's a change leadership book. There's nothing in there I believe that would shock most people. You would be surprised at some of the things it says, but it reinforces good best practices for working with in people and organizations. There's been a just Don has taken quite frankly, this is work that was perfect, that was kind of paused during COVID. And there's been a huge amount of lift to revitalize our emergency operating procedures in the district. You have a sample plan, and he asked if we should print the whole thing. I suggest you can see one plan. These exist for all buildings, not for the principals and the teams and every single building that creates these. This is a template model that is supported by the conference management and sheriff's office. It's a coordinated effort. This replaces all of our somewhat confusing procedures, and most importantly for you as a board, if you look at where's the one page you have with
it's a big clip.
Don knows page 64, and we're impressed by that. If you look at page 64, these are the terms that we use in the district now and we will use these terms in communication with you as well. So when we communicate out to you about a situation in the district, we're going to universally use these. And for people that have been around a while, these have changed over time. Lock in, lock out, code yellow, code red, John Smith's in the hall. There's a number of different codes and non-codes that have been used over a period of time. And this is very simple. Color corresponds to some things within some tabs that are within this. Classroom teachers in individual rooms have a codes mean. So we will, if we have a situation where we have a lockdown, we will use the word lockdown and explain what that is. But if you read through this, this is the access, just an example. You'll see what the conditions of that will be. Shelter and secure.
Installed on the day they arrive. So
large machines, the production machines that impact our high schools and middle schools the most, are going to be invented next week. So that's slower than we wanted, but faster than we were promised. So we'll take it.
Do the kids get to use the copy machines at all? The older kids, I'm talking about high school kids, say they had a project they need to make copies of. Can they have access? Do they have access, or do they have to go to a teacher and hope that teacher lets them have access? Just curious.
The media clerk will make a copy for them, mm-hmm. but they don't have direct access.
Okay, somebody will make a copy if they need it.
Correct.
So they can't really take pictures of, they can't use the copy.
So they're not supposed to take teacher's keys and use it to make. The teacher shouldn't be giving the student keys.
No, but somebody will give them, right. Okay.
Where printing is done in the media centers. There's printers in there that kids can use in the morning before school, let's say, if they don't have a printer at home.
Yeah.
So they have access to a small individual printer.
It's like, say, somebody's going to do a presentation to their class, and they need copies of a graph or something for their class that would be made.
Yes. I thought it was a loaded question for a second.
No, I don't have loaded questions.
That is the way.
That wasn't meant to be that loud.
No, I just want to know if the high school kids, I can see where they would need it. And I was curious, do they have access anyway?
Mm-hmm. They all have access to submit things electronically as well. So I think we're ahead of the game there.
Yeah, in that situation, they may just email it to the teachers through an electronic submission, right?
Mm-hmm.
What happens most often is they take a picture of the document with their phone.
Scan it.
Yeah.
Adobe scan.
Mm-hmm.
That was
okay.
No for Adobe.
Okay, I'm not trying to make this going faster or slower than people wanted to go, but it is an update. If you have specific questions, I can bring them back to you if you hold in the very near future or at the other point. I'm just looking at our time and what we're trying to accomplish in this 2 hours. So if there are questions about that, that's great. If not, I'll make some transitions to strategic
plan.
Let's go.
Okay.
Thank you for that update.
You have a strategic plan in front of you. It is exactly the same format as it's been in the past. I think this is something, I'll be honest with you, we're going to talk about this as a year goes on. This is something we should consider looking at more formally going forward. This is the board, to me, this is community and board input to set direction in the district. So we are working through an existing plan right now. You'll see we use the same format as before. We show prior year and current year. We show prior year and current year every single one of the sub-goals throughout this document. They're all addressed. You may see more or less going on in one area or another. Some areas, obviously, last year were up to that to some extent.
Department, We will, and we actually have started this, met to look at what software subscriptions we have and determine which ones to move forward with, look closer at, and monitor their effectiveness for teaching and learning. We will share the revised instructional fundamentals, which are kind of like our list of non-negotiables. They have been revised to include some statewide focus on the essentials so that those live within each of the buildings and serve as the basis for PD and school improvement plans. And we are thrilled to continue our district-wide initiative to promote disciplinary literacy in all classrooms, all grades, and all contents. Kim and I are happy to report that all buildings have disciplinary literacy goals in their school improvement plans for this year. There was a focus on opening day, and we will continue to support that effort in the remainder of the year and years to come.
With the social workers, and so if a student asks for time with a social worker, how many days do they have to wait before the social worker is available?
They should be able to be seen that day.
That day, okay.
It shouldn't be a wait period.
Okay, because that I know the counselors, before we got all the people, the counselors would tell them sometimes 3 or 4 days, I can see you in 3 or 4 days. That's not fixing the problem.
Well, 21.
I was going to say longer, weeks. Mm-hmm.
21, yeah.
Weeks.
Yeah.
Thank you.
I think we really tried to, this will come out of the plan, but social workers are a mental health professional. Everyone's, they're all mental health professionals, but social workers are focused on more acute issues dealing with mental health and students. So their ability to intervene because they're dealing with kids that need help more immediately.
Yeah.
And we have to, there's work to be done with counselors so that they are picking up and working on this as well. But the primary function of social work is to support students in greater mental health needs. Counselors are supportive of that. The primary job of counselors is to support academic needs of students. Social workers support that.
Well, yeah, but if a student goes to the counselor, and how long will they have to wait? So maybe make an appointment to see the counselor.
That has improved. I don't know exactly what. I don't have data for you on that.
Because
that was a significant issue.
that, you know, they're going to their counselor, but that's not who they really need to see. They need the social worker, but they don't understand the difference.
There is a system in building where the social worker receives referrals from a number of sources. It's not just waiting that the student knows who they are, for example. It's like the student doesn't have to know the social worker is in the building. We wouldn't expect most students to know who the social worker is in the building, perhaps. They're referred to them.
Shane.
Nancy, I just had a question, because going along with Amy's concerns, you know, I think we made a lot of progress on this last year. We passed, you know, that resolution. But in terms of screening, so expanding upon Amy's question, when a student comes into the counseling office, you know, albeit voluntary, goes into the counseling office, I'm talking secondary, what is the screening that's done at the time that they even, let's say, make an appointment? Because most of the time it's just a, you know, it's a secretary at the desk there, you know, that's, you're signing up to get an appointment. Is there a way where, you know, a student can make their concern known in a way where it's urgent, you know, or in a way where, okay, this one can, you know, this one is less urgent. This one, if it needs to wait a couple days, it can wait a couple days.
Right, or, you know, the student comes in and they want to talk to a counselor, but when you get down to the nitty gritty of it, it's not a counselor they need. They need to see someone else. They're being abused, but they're going to their counselor to say what can they do when it should be a social worker.
And I'll let Kim answer what it looks like when a student goes down to the counseling office. But usually there are other signs that maybe a teacher or someone else might be picking up. And there are other ways that we're observing student behavior, student needs in the building. So it's not just always a direct link to a counselor. There are multiple sources that are aware. If there are things going on or differences noticed in the student, if not, I don't know exactly what it looks like in the building when a student goes down to the counselor to sign up with the secretary. However, if there's ever a concern, I can assure you that the staff in the building know who the school social workers are and are making referrals.
Yeah, that was my specific question. It was like a chain of command of where something would go.
It's more into a process that we can
You can't ask the secretary to triage.
Right.
No.
Right. They're not qualified.
Let's look at that and see if there's a process that we either can just speak about more formally or we need to look at. Okay. I understand what you're saying.
It's not a formal process, but it does get done.
Right. Yeah, I just wonder if there was some kind of chain of command that's documented in a way. Go ahead, Kim. Sorry.
His parents had a big blow up at home.
Right.
And they separated, and the kids like get lost. They go to their counselor's office because that's where they know to go. And it's not what the counselor, they need a social worker at that point.
Okay, let's let Kim.
So, as my former experience in the high school, there is a process. They have clipboards set up, but they are greeted immediately by the secretary that sits right in the counseling office. Obviously, she can gauge if that student is in immediate need based on if they're crying or something like that. But the question is asked, is this of immediate nature? Do you need to be seen immediately? Otherwise, they sign up. And because the clipboards are out, it's just, is this, you know, do you need to be seen immediately? Is this, and they ask for a description of what it might be about. Is it a schedule change? Is it, you know, counseling based on academics?
Right.
So there is an initial screening done as they come in. But there's also a digital process set up too, so it goes right to counselors.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't remember right off the top of my head what those questions were asked, but it would go directly to their counselor. So there is a way digitally they can sign up to see their counselors. And I know the buildings are starting, just because I'm part of the counseling meetings, they're starting those 1-minute meetings where they go to classrooms and they communicate obviously with the teacher and they bring kids out for a quick check-in, 1-minute check-in, Okay. I last a little bit longer than that, but they call them 1 minute check-ins. But instead of taking that time to walk to and from the counseling office, the counselor's actually going to the classroom, right. And it's just quick. How you doing? What do you need? And then a referral can be made there. So the initial part is with the counselor, but then they're referred to.
Oh, thank you. Mm-hmm. That's very helpful.
Yeah, thank you for that clarification.
Okay, continue. All right.
Child study team process actually was revised by staff and updated, and it's starting to be utilized now for child study teams. All K-5 students will be provided with individualized intervention based on NWEA scores using exact path. Building teams, including literacy specialists, interventionists, instructional coaches, teachers will utilize spring and fall data to determine and implement interventions including corrective reading and support classes for students.
We spoke about
earlier. Right. Yes. LCPS elementary students will participate in activities that involve students in local causes such as endangered species, homeless shelters, nursing homes, recycling, etc. Continue to explore and expand course offerings and extracurricular opportunities based on a wide range of student interests. District continues to receive 100% on B13 transition. State transition monitoring. And B13 is the transition activities that our students with IEPs participate in. We have, as long as I've been here, we've been achieving 100% compliance, and that means we meet all of the criteria each year based on our audit of many files that are submitted to the ISD and then submitted to the state of Michigan for the criteria in our IEPs and all of the activities, goals and objectives that we're required to do and that we do for students as they are transitioning through high school, getting ready for post-secondary opportunities. District continues to expand and revise transition opportunities in response to students' individual needs and strengths in order to address the post-graduation transition goals, which I just mentioned.
Next goal refers to student experiences. Speaking of engaging in the learning experiences supported by enrichment opportunities and interventions of developers to both academic success. Let's go 2022-23 elementary schools. Go ahead.
So all elementary schools, as part of their school improvement plan, will include the use of exact path in their intervention plans. The secondary one-to-one committee is utilizing teacher feedback from 21-22 to continue to meet and review and improve the implementation of one-to-one technology in the classroom. Our building teams will analyze the fall data to develop intervention plans for our at-risk students. And we will continue using Zello and its capability to maintain student-centered process for our EDPs, our educational development plans, and as part of scheduling each spring as students create their schedule. The second part of this is resuming clubs and extracurricular offerings such as robotics club and other clubs based on student interest, eliciting input from students regarding future opportunities, continuing to offer leadership opportunities through DECA, the Leader in Me, Senior Honors Project, Link Crew at the high school level, web at the middle school level, participation in state leadership conferences, and expanding extracurricular opportunities, offering esports at the high school level.
So Beth, I'm just for familiarity, I think most people are familiar with the Creuse high school level, which is our student monitoring program for most of the ninth grade students.
had this program called WEB at some of our middle schools, and that's been expanded this year. So it's a similar induction program for sixth grade students, supported by eighth grade students who are also trained. So it's really neat.
It is.
It's accessible. It's a very, especially for middle school, and it's kind of, there's a nice piece that they're not exactly the same. WEB's appropriate for middle school students, and LINK's appropriate for high school students, but they get an induction experience with another student or group of kids in both secondary programs. And finance, with the finance goal, it's rather black and white. You can see 21-22, 22-23, that comes right out goals. And we did take down the suggestion of Hillary's suggestion of amending the 2% bump balance goal if you look at spending saving for next year.
So I can put a plug in that next month we'll be bringing the audit, and I do expect that we'll be a little bit better than the amended budget projections. Mm-hmm. So
yeah, we're on time for the normal time frame for audit, which is presentation at committee of the whole.
Correct.
And request for acceptance at voting meeting.
Like, what are you talking about? We just approved the budget.
So
that's what it feels like.
I understand.
Yeah, we met this for 2 years
ago.
We've been into November once, we went in November a couple years ago, and there's, I don't know. Anyway, we cleaned up that. The process is clean, that it meets the October 31st send to the state before, and your eyes on the
process
before that happens.
Yeah.
Yep.
So on 11, go ahead.
So we just finished Schools of Choice. It closed week before our last, so we're working on getting all that data together to analyze it. The transitional kindergarten enrollment is very steady. Demand slightly exceeds seats. I believe we ended up with 2 on the waiting list when it shook out. Sometimes people are a little more interested than they think they are. Their kid is really not ready, they're not eligible, or it's not a good fit for them. We have expanded GSRP, the Great Start Readiness Program, that is preschool, that is funded through the state and has been expanded for 22-23, and we're also planning more seats for 23-24 after some renovations at Birdie, and that is fully funded by the state of Michigan. There are income requirements for it at initially. However, if you have filled all of those seats and you still have demand, we can expand a little bit on those requirements as well.
So I want to walk on that because there's opportunity here. There was opportunity here, and now there really is opportunity. Someone made a suggestion to expand a TK program to additional students and take TK and make it for more quarter rolls and just fund it. GSRP is a potential partial answer to that. It is income-based. However, it's been under-enrolled at the county. You can use a county-wide effort for this, and we would, as of this past spring state, we'd be able to enroll a far enough larger number of students over the income threshold than our goal right now. The other thing is you receive a full foundation grant for GSRP students now.
That's
relatively new.
That's great.
A very small amount of money received for those students. So you can support higher wages for instructors in those programs as well, and more kids are eligible. So there's real expansion opportunities here. It can become a contiguous program between that, TK, K, et cetera, and something we really want to look at. Finding space to do this is more of a challenge than it is anything else. But, you know, early childhood teachers are perfect fits for this program, and there are, we have a larger number of seats allocated to us now. So, okay. Can you expand the program?
Anyway. Eric, quick question about, you just mentioned about seats, but also staffing.
Yes.
How are we at staffing in early childhood? Because I know, we've seen on our employment recommendations, there's been a lot of, there's openings in that department.
Well, Laura gave me GM this morning.
Oh, there we go.
Bad news is, the good news is plenty of people on our programs. The bad news is there's a waiting list for many of them because we have staffing issues in these programs. So I would say at this point, it's not directly off this. This is probably something I'd like to expand on in a committee, well, poll, perhaps a closed session to discuss negotiations, but not in 30 minutes, but in the near future. We've been talking about this a lot. We have greater interest for our pay and GSRP programs. We have, and this has been an organ solid in the district, both at our Birdie Center and at the Lawrence Creuse Childhood Center at Graham Element, next, you know, attached to that. I don't know how to say this. There are wage inhibitors to hiring staff in this area right now. And this is really, we made a lot of progress in other areas of the district. We made progress in a lot of nods areas. We made progress with social workers. We made progress in some other areas that we had not made as much progress with 6-7 months ago. This area has not made as much progress, just being honest. And we have families in London. So there is work to be done there, and it will require some discussion from the board on what we can and should do about that.
Okay.
That's what I'll say about that.
Okay.
Fourth community goal, 14 is last year, some things that happened last year, 15 goes to things for this year.
Everybody's doing it, really.
Right, so my point is, if that helped us to be a leader in gaining subs in that area, and we have the people that actually just want to sub, there's a number of people out there that want to do substitute teaching, because of the flexibility of it, they stay, and because they work as much as they want to. And so, I mean, I think directly hiring them is successful, and I think we can take a look at how we can expand that as much as possible.
Mount Clements has got a sign up that says they want to hire a substitute teacher. I think they're hiring substitutes to be full-time teachers because they lost so many.
That's a very different and challenging conversation.
Yeah. Right. Eric, you'd like to thank you for your education department.
we may, despite the fact that we can't drive south for North on Gratiot Avenue right now, and Don just told me that that's actually going to have to go for another week.
What?
I was happy to hear that this morning. So anyway, we have bus drivers. It's a different challenge, which is the take a tour of them and so on.
Yeah. Now North River, I drove here, North River's down to one.
The last thing after this is that we continue working with Charbals. We have a new food service director, you know, working very well. Jeff is the Charbals supervisor now, and they work very well together, continuing those programs and looking at other things to bring food nutrition programs to kids. They're big farmers. They have good ideas. They bring things to us. Hey, what do you think about this? And they're always really creative and interesting ideas. That's the last thing.
Okay. Any questions, comments? I suppose if something comes to you, you can certainly email Eric, and he'll respond to the full board. But that was a great update. Any questions, comments before we go to the next and last item? Okay, well, so then the next thing on the agenda is board policy recommendation. This is just simply a catch-all where our policy committee, I think it was originally requested back in March, and the policy committee met to look at Article 4, Community Relations, and the Section 4.4.2. And then we have administrative guidelines that were revised. And so just to give the background, the policy committee met in July, and they brought forward to our committee of the whole in August. And there was a lot of discussion about this. And then what's attached to to the agenda is the one that the policy committee brought forward. And then in yellow were the changes that we wanted to make relative to our discussions at our August meeting. So all we really want to do at this point is just encourage the policy committee to take that conversation that we've had at several meetings and see if we can't come to wording and a process and procedure that the board will support. I should also say that in line with what we've discussed, having the guidelines to address complaints against board members as far as administrative guideline, it seems to me, and we had discussion about that, that might be better to be a policy. But I'm trying to think who's the policy committee. I think it's Hillary, mm-hmm. and then there's, and Amy and Sharon. So we've had a lot of discussion, a lot of it's on tape. So we just really look forward to trying to figure out a way to navigate the questions and concerns that came up and come to something that everybody might support. And that's all that's about. So any other, let me see where we're at on that. Okay, any other matters? Yeah.
I just want to say something about that policy conversation.
Yeah.
It's kind of lived on.
Yeah.
And it's been passionate.
Mm-hmm.
But from my perspective, and a lot of this is your work, you can implement or not.
Right.
This is not required. You know what I mean? We're not like meeting some sort of a mandate on any of these things.
Right.
I only suggest, my job, I think, is to advocate for staff within the district. I always suggest we look at something to protect staff to make a choice on whether or not, as the OMA provides, that they have a closed session. We have lots of strong opinions on the board about closed session and how they would want to use it or how they would feel about it or how they would put it. But I'm just looking for something for staff. to have a closed or not have a closed session. That's all. That's all. That's all I ask for is consideration on that. There's a lot of other stuff here, a lot of other moving parts, but I'm just looking to comply with the OMA, but be in a position of being able to protect employees when part of our open meetings process is we don't know what people are going to say or what they're going to say. So that's
Shane.
Eric, you agree that the procedures for matters regarding a board member should not be an administrative guideline?
I don't think the superintendent or designee should be in the process of dealing with issues that involve board members brought by outside people. I don't.
Right.
And I don't think that that's the role of administration. I don't think it's the role of the board. So having said that, if you choose to do something in this area, I suggest it's a policy, since the policies are quote unquote owned by the board,
right,
versus administrative guidelines are administrator's job. So maybe that's just kind of maybe it's just the right thing to do. Maybe it doesn't really, in technical sense, it doesn't matter. But I feel like the board or something like that, it's the rest of the policy because it's the board's work and not the administrator's guideline, if it were to happen.
So I think I can move to adjourn here, right?
One more comment on that.
I just made a motion to adjourn.
I didn't
say. Nobody seconded.
No, you were done with discussion. What you were going to. The post committee, or when a committee meeting is scheduled, it's my understanding from the past that we would, that information would be posted, and then there would be some sort of cursory summary notes about that. So, not that other people would have to participate, but they would have the opportunity to.
What do you mean it would be posted?
We had talked about before.
We post our minutes as soon as.
No. We're talking about when the policy committee meets.
When
the policy committee meets, yes. So I want to know what you're saying about posting. Could Terry finish?
Oh, sorry. Yeah, sure.
What did you mean by posting, Terry?
No, I'm just saying in the past, we talked about the fact that even though we have members that are on the particular committee, there might be other board members that might be interested in just hearing the conversation.
You can't.
That's why it goes to first reading.
Because you'd have quorum.
Yeah, that's why it goes to first reading.
Okay.
And then you have a big discussion, you go to second reading, and like in this case, if we couldn't come to an agreement, we'd have a big discussion, then we punt it to another, you know, revise, come back, and do it again.
Okay.
So that's why first and second reading on all policy changes.
Okay, yeah, you're right. I do remember that. What about summary of what went on at the committee?
That's right away.
That's my responsibility.
Oh, it is?
I apologize if that's been delayed in the past. That's my fault.
Oh, okay. All right.
I try to stay on top of that when those come into me.
They're posted on your board pages.
Okay.
That's the meeting. Was that
Yeah. Hillary?
Just for clarification, whenever any ad hoc committee or subcommittee meets, it is required that they provide an agenda and minutes from that meeting to the entire board.
Okay.
The way that it has worked, it has been going in the past, is it goes to the superintendent and the superintendent disperses all the information to the board, just like the superintendent usually disperses all the information to the board.
Okay.
Any ad hoc or any standing subcommittee is required to present their agenda and their meeting minutes to the entire board.
Which includes the date and who is the committee members too.
Okay.
So now I motion to adjourn.
Okay.
Anybody
want a
second?
Second.
That we wired up the any more questions thing
right.
First.
Right.
That's always important.
So, not running a meeting.
Okay. All those in favor?
What was that, Mary?
Aye.
What was that? What were you saying
those
to me?
Those opposed? Meeting adjourned.